tu veux. Ok, fine. Yeah, that's horrible. So, everybody here, everybody okay? So, okay, I'm here to talk to you about integrating OCS inventory with a third-party software. So, I think you also, the lecture this morning with Yannick and François. Hello. So, first of all, I'm presenting myself. I work at FactoryFX, a French company specialized in open source software. So we are partners with OCS Inventory, and we tend to develop it more and more. So to make things better, like a nicer interface and things like that. So I'm a developer, and I work primarily on the OCS server and the user interface. Okay. So I'll start with a few simple questions. What's OCS inventory and what is it good at? So first, it's good for inventory, obviously. So to get information on your network, your computers, what software are installed on your computers and everything. It's good for network discovery, so to discover devices you didn't even know about. And it's also good to deploy software. So you can deploy any software you want if you have the agent installed on your computers. What OCS inventory is not good at, or what does it do poorly? It's not a help desk, so if your users have a problem with their computers, you have no need to track, you have no means to track bugs or everything. It's not a monitoring software, so you can't see if one of your servers is down. It's not done for that, and it's not a stock management system, so you can't follow how much computers you have in stock. It's not made for that. So how can OCS be useful for this kind of situations? OCS can provide some up-to-date data about your whole infrastructure, and it can be very customizable, so you can put plugins on your computers, and they'll get you like the version of Microsoft Office you installed on it, or things like that. And you can automate the process, so you can get your information from OCS. It comes every day automatically, and you can put it in the software you want. So that's the goal of this talk. It's to make the bridge between OCS and other software like OpenNMS, or I think about GLPI. I don't know if you've heard about it. So why use web services when we could simply get into the database and get the information we want? The web services provide you with backwards compatibility, so you have the insurance that the bridge you developed to integrate OCS data in your software will always be there and will always work, even if you update your installation of OCS inventory. You get security because you can manage who can access to the web services, and furthermore you are ensured that you won't mess with the database. You also get simplicity because half the job is done by the server, so you don't have to treat cases that were already treated by OCS. So, during this talk, I'll go through the following points. So first, what kind of data can you get from OCS? Then I'll tell you a bit how to configure the web services. And then we'll go through a few exercises to query your inventory and to keep up to date with your inventory. So first, what can you get from OCS? So the first important thing is the inventory is the main thing you want to get from the web services. So you can get information about your hardware, your software, and your administrative data. Sorry for my accent, it's a bit difficult. So to do that, you have a notion of checksum in OCS inventory. This checksum helps you to keep track of what has been updated since the agents came back to your server. And it helps you to select what kind of data you want to get from the web services. So it's a 32-bit number, and each bit is coding for a section of your inventory. Like if you want to get your monitors, you'll get a specific bit, which is this one, 64. So in fact, you just put there a number, and you can get only the information you want and the information that has been updated since the last time you went to your inventory. So the SOAP API for the inventory. The main methods to query the inventory are getComputers. So in the SOAP API for CS, you always have V1 or V2. It's just to ensure backwards compatibility. V2 are methods that are more up to date and that are more generally useful. So getComputers V1 gets an XML request to filter the data and get what you want. Then you can delete a few computers with the second one. You can reset the checksum to say that you have gotten the data you wanted from your computer. So now the checksum is at zero. So the next time you query, you won't have this computer again. Then you can query which computers were deleted through OCS, or were renamed, or were merged. And that's through the methods get history, and you can clear this history with the second one. It's pretty obvious. So you can get the computers which were deleted, and then delete these computers which were deleted, so you won't have them the next time. You can also query the configuration of OCS, so you can get and set the values. And you can query the information you put in the software dictionary. So that's a kind of mapping to say this software, I will give this name to this software. So it's a bit of configuration. So here are the methods to access this configuration. So here there is the V1 and V2. It's due to an upgrade in OCS. At first, the configurations were only integer values, and then you get some string values like paths to log files or things like that. So they added a second method where you can specify which value you want and where you can update a specific value, either an integer value or a string value. And then you can get all the software in your dictionary software, which are represented by a specific one. You can also query the devices that were discovered through IP Discover. So IP Discover is a feature from OCS where you get one computer in a network, and it queries through Nmap or IP Discover to see which computers you don't have in your inventory but are present on the network. So it can be very useful. You can tag these devices, so you can give them a type, a name, and a user. And you can manage the device types you want to put into IP Discover. So, for example, we can say this device is a router, or this other one is a server or computer. So these are the methods you can use for that. So to query the IP discover devices, you can you have to specify an offset and a date. So when were they discovered, and the offset is there to manage pagination. You can remove elements by their MAC address, and you can tag and untag with the MAC address, give them a description, a type, and a user. And then you can create types and delete types. And at the end, you can get information about devices that were discovered through SNMP. So that's a bit more complicated. Actually, this method was brought in the 2.1 version of OCS, so it's not complete right now. So you can't track which devices were deleted or are not present anymore, or which one were updated, or things like that. You can't track this. You only have one method, is to filter which SNMP devices were added on your network. Okay, so then how to configure the web service API? So it's pretty simple. You only have to put this option to 1. It's at 0 by default. And then you can also configure. I think I got mistaken on the second one. Actually, I'll show you later. Actually, it's the number of records that will be given to you for one request. So to manage pagination, for example, if you have a thousand computers in your inventory, in this example, you only get 100 by 100. So you have to manage the offset. Then you have to add credentials in the Apache configuration. So to keep the SOAP API a bit closed, so it's a security measure. So it's just a username and password. It's a classic Apache configuration. There are a few pitfalls. When you install an OCS server, it checks for SOAP dependencies, but these dependencies are optional. So if you didn't have them installed, you'll have to install them when you enable the SOAP API. On recent installs, some Perl modules can be too much up to date. For example, on a Debian Wheezy, you have this module, HTTP messages, that is on version 6.0.6, and you have to get it on version 6.0.4. So you have to beware about the versions of the modules that OCS needs to make the API work. Then we'll get through a few series of exercises to query the inventory. We won't go through IP discover nor SNMP. It's pretty much the same way of thinking. So I think the inventory will be enough for first. So I prepared a little interface. So we're gonna see in PHP how to make this work. I kept it very simple on purpose. So we won't have objects, we won't have XML SAX parsers, we won't have things like that. It's just so everybody can understand. And I'll show you a few pitfalls you have to beware when you use the OCS SOAP API, because some things are not very clean, and you get to walk around things from time to time. So each time I show you how things are done, then the result of the request we were making. So first, how to set up a SOAP client in PHP for OCS. A few things you have to be aware of, it's that you have to get a SOAP 1.1 version. And if you want to debug what OCS gives you back, you have to enable the trace function in the SOAP client of PHP. So that's just a utility function, very simple, to build a SOAP client. So that's the standard SOAP client of PHP. So here are the parameters you have to give it. I'll give you after that, you have the possibility to download these files. Okay, so I put everything on my server, so you can have this at this URL. And the password and user and password are these ones. So we make the first request. So the first request is going to be very simple. It's just getting one element of configuration from OCS. So the first configuration element we are going to get is this one. So it's a simple integer. And it's simply done like that. So I don't know if any of you has already used SOAP APIs. Maybe I'll start with that. So the principle of a SOAP API is that you should be able to use it as if you had an object, a real object between your hands. So the purpose is that you have a client and you call methods on it and you give him parameters and it works just as if you added as if you had the code on your server. So that's how it's used usually. So to get the configuration value, you just have to call this as if you had built this class on your server, but all is dynamic. I didn't have to write a line of code to get this to work. So the first configuration element will be prolog freq. So it's an integer. So here it's pretty obvious. We get it pretty easily. And the second element I want you to see is this first path. So is it this one? So it's a string. It's a string configuration element. So there, when you call OCS config v1, you get a nice zero integer and not at all the /10 value we saw earlier. So you have to call the OCS config v2. The result is a kind of an XML document. And it gives you, in fact, the integer value and the text value that you have for this entry. So, in this example, it's the only way you have to get the string value. So you can call the v1 version, which is simpler if you have a string value. Okay. Now we'll try fetching some computers. So I'll go through the request element after. It's just to show you some of the pitfalls we can go through when we query OCS. So we query the computers with this method, and the result we get is a bit weird. It's not an XML. It's not an XML document. We get, in fact, an array of XML themes. So it's not very clean. And if we want to see the raw SOAP XML we get behind, you can see that, in fact, OCS doesn't manage SOAP very well, so you get read XML and false XML that's impacted in it. So you have to work around this. So the first thing to do is to have a utility method to get proper XML from OCS. So it's quite simple. We call the method of the SOAP client, and then we concatenate. If we get an array of elements, we concatenate them, and we get proper XML. So now, when I use my utility function, I get this result, which looks a bit more like XML. And the configuration stays the same. So, for this workshop, to pass the XML, I'll only use a simple XML. So it's not very good for performance, and it's just simple. So I think it's clearer this way. It would be nicer to have a SAX parser. To not load everything in memory and to treat elements one by one. Okay, so querying the inventory. So the method to query the inventory is getComputersV1. It takes a few parameters to filter and to select which value you want to get. So the first thing is the metadata. So here I build my request. The first parameter engine is always the same. For now it's the first. It's in the future there will be surely a second that will be more efficient and more flexible. Asking for is a parameter. It can be either metadata or inventory. If you get meta, it's a simple resume. It's a simple abstract of what you get in your computer. So you have the last date where the computer was contacted, the last inventory it made. You get its name, its ID, and the checksum. So which sections were updated, and the tag you define. So here I get a few. Then you can get administrative data. So in OCS, administrative data are free fields, kind of free fields. You can configure and add your data to a computer. So you can, for example, specify a place where it is located or a user which is concerned by this computer. So you can query it by specifying a wanted parameter. So in the wanted parameter, you can either get the account info or the dictionary software. It's like the checksum. It's a system of flags, so you can combine the two. If you want all the information, you'll pass it a 3. If you want only the dictionary soft, it's 2, and only the account info, it's 1. So here, I get a sample of account info. So I can see the tag, I can see the service. Then you can ask for computer sections. So that's the interesting part where you get all your inventory. So here is the different values that can take the checksum parameter. So it's a system of flags, so you can combine these ones and it will get you the sections you want. So for example, here is the max checksum, so it's this one and its value is 1,048,575. It's a big number. So here, if I put this number in my request, I will have all the sections. It's a big data. So you have to filter it, because if you want really everything, it can be very big. For example, if you want the software, for my computer, the software, there might be like 900. So if you get even 100 records with 900 software for each, it can give you a big amount of data. So here is how I build the query. And the result it gives me. So I put a checksum of 3. It says I want the BIOS and the hardware information. So here is the result. I get the computers with their BIOS data and hardware data. Then you can filter by tag and ID. For example, here I only want the metadata for the computer 13 and 21. So you can give it multiple IDs if you want. And here is the result. Then you can filter by tag. It's the same principle. You can give it multiple tags. So here I asked for metadata and all computers that are tagged smartphone and Arthur. So these are mine. And I get this kind of result. So for now, I only had 5 computers, because in my OCS installation, I put 5 as a parameter to the max number of results it returns me. But I actually have 16 computers in my installation. It's a demo installation, so it's not very big. So how to put pagination in place? So here is my 5 computers, and then I can ask for a begin parameter, and it will give me the 5 next computers. So here I put 5. So that's how you do. You have to put an offset that's named begin, and you have to take the next 5 computers each time. So it's a bit cumbersome, so how to do it automatically? I'd like to get all the computers from my installation, and so I would like to ask the metadata for all the computers, and I would ask it to give me 16 computers. I have a slight problem, is that to achieve this, I have to update the value for the begin, so to get the first 5 computers, then the next, then the next. So I can't give it an XML request like I did before. I have to build the request dynamically with the begin parameter. So how to achieve this? I just built a little utility function to build the request from an array, and then it's easier to have a dynamic request built with an updated offset. So the result of this utility function is that I have a request built. So now, to get all computers, this is the little function I built. So I have to start at the offset 0 and then get the 5 first computers, put the offset at 5 and then at 10 and then at 15. So I have to loop. So I have to first get the request, get the offset parameter into the request, So here I use the utility function I built earlier to build the request. And then I actually get the data. I have to parse it in XML here, so that I can add each computer in an array that will be returned at the end. So I increment the counter. And as in the information returned by OCS, I have no idea how many records I have in the end. So how many records I have in my total inventory. And I have no idea what the configuration for the number, I have no way to know the configuration for the number of records I get for each page. So it has to be done statically at the top. So here I know I put 5 in my configuration. So I have to do it completely statically. I don't have a way to get this configuration information. So the only way I have to know that I've come at the end of my result set is that the results that OCS gave me is the number of results it gave me is less than the number of results per page I have. So in action, here I want always the first engine, and I want the metadata. And when I call my function, I have 16 computers written. Okay. So next, you have to find a way to keep track of updated records, because you don't want to get all your computers every time. It would be a big amount of data, especially if your inventory is pretty big. So to achieve this, you have to manage the checksum of your computers. So each time an agent puts its inventory into the server, it updates the checksum value of the computer to say, my hardware has been updated, so you have to keep it updated. Or my BIOS has changed, so it puts the flag BIOS on the checksum value to 1. So here, for example, I query for computers which have an updated value for their hardware section, and I get 2 results back with their hardware. Now I want to say that I have the data about my computer, so I don't want to have it the next time if it hasn't been updated. So I have to call this function to reset the checksum to a value of 0, so that the next time I query the inventory, I won't have it marks that every value has not been updated. So I won't get the value again. So I will only get it if the agent of this computer has updated its values. So after I call this function, so after I reset the checksum on one of my computers, when I do the query again, I only have one computer, the second one, because I didn't reset the checksum on the second one. So that's the way of limiting the traffic to computers that were only updated. Then keeping track of deleted records. In OCS, you have to activate an option that's named trace deleted to enable this. So when you activate this option, each time you delete a computer in OCS, it will be added to a table, and the computer itself will be removed. But we OCS will keep track that this computer that was deleted. So you can query this information through this method and you get this result. So here you can see that these four elements were actually deleted from your system. So that's the way of keeping track of a computer that were deleted from OCS. So that was it for the exercises. I hope it was clear enough. It's a lot faster than I expected, so maybe I spoke too fast. I don't know if you understood me well. If you have any question, please feel free to ask. Yeah?
The checksums. So there's one checksum that's filtering what kind of device I get.
Sorry?
But there's one checksum with purpose to filter what kind of device you get and how much
you
get out of it.
It's the same parameter to filter and select what you want to get back. So you can't, for example, get the BIOS information of only the computers that have a hardware updated. If you want the BIOS information, you'll have to filter on the BIOS too. So that's a limitation of OCS. It's the same parameter to filter and to display. I don't know if you get what I mean.
I'm not sure.
Okay.
So if we use a checksum of, let's say, 4,034, what exactly checksum we are using? I think by default we query with a checksum of 4,099.
Sorry, 2 seconds, I'll just...
I have live demo if you want to make some tests.
So you say
4,099.
4,099.
They're tuning to BIOS and hardware.
And also networks.
Networks. I think a few assets, but no. I think pretty little amount of software information. Right?
Yeah. No. You won't get software information.
Okay, that's okay. So. How is this checksum number affected by this? When was the computer updated checksum thing?
In fact, the way of tracking this is when you get this information and you put it in your third-party software, you have to reset the checksum to zero so that next time you won't get this information again. And then when the agent from this specific computer puts its in its inventory in OCS, if it has new information on the networks, for example, the checksum you will have this information again. I don't know if you get what I mean.
So if I request two times, if I do the same request two times in a row.
You will still have the same right now?
Yeah, but I reset what is the definition of resetting the checksum?
The definition, it's a... In fact, you can give it a specific checksum. So if you want to say, okay, I have the network data, I don't want it next time, you can get the checksum from this computer, which will be here, and remove the flag from the networks. And the next time, you want to get only computers who have networks updated, you won't have this one. You know.
So the term checksum is one is in a get computer query is mainly used to determine what parts of the information you want to have.
Yeah.
But the agent updates a checksum value on the computer, which is just another. It's more like a timing and update tracker, right?
Sorry.
So it's a checksum on the computer.
Yeah.
Like in that case.
It's
26, 21, 43 is just like an update counter.
Yeah.
How often has been updated. So
yeah.
They are not strictly related, right? So it's just two.
Yeah. And
so both are called checksum, but they are...
A checksum is not the good word, I think, for this kind of value. It's not very appropriate, but that's the word.
So they are not the same, right? There's a checksum
for
filtering the amount of data you get.
No,
it's
actually
checksum for filtering how old
this
update should be.
But
so
actually,
domains, right?
Actually, it's the same. You don't have information. You only have information on when the last inventory was made by the agent. You don't have information for each section. When it was made,
okay.
You only have the checksum
for the entire machine.
Yeah, and when you ask for computers with a given checksum, it's used to manage the sections that are displayed and filter the elements.
Mm-hmm.
It's used for both.
Okay.
So it's not very flexible.
Okay. And if we would make this. Request and then we call the request check something.
Yeah,
we
I think that would be.
Just get machines that haven't been in the last request.
Yeah.
Or that have updated in the time frame. Okay.
Isn't there a race condition in these flags? When you read the change information and after that you reset the flags, what did the information change between reading and resetting the flags?
Yes, that might be a problem, indeed. Well, there's no clean way to be sure right now. Actually,
you should rather give me the information and reset the flag in one step.
Yeah, that's right. That can be a problem if the agent does the inventory between the two steps, it can be a problem. But it's not very frequent, yeah. But
it
can
happen.
Really
happen, but
yeah.
There's still place for get computer version 3, right? So we had some issues that if we call the data set, maybe of that precision, like this hardware, this BIOS, that we don't get a lot of, or the requests get pretty slow.
Yeah.
So are there any things that we are obviously doing wrong in that cases, or is it just a lot of work to do before you can send it out?
How do you get these kind of requests? Do you do the kind of thing I did, like paginating?
Yeah.
If you want to keep things alright for the other users of OCS, you might want to keep like a timing between requests or something like that to avoid things making it work for a long time a lot, I think.
Okay.
There might be some optimizations to do from OCS side too.
Cases, so we reduce down the amount of information we get for this provisioning thing.
Yeah, you have to filter.
It was just getting too quickly in the 20-minute response time. It was just
For how many computers?
So 600 devices, less a big checksum.
And the big bottleneck here is really the softwares, because as I said, you can get a lot of information in this. So my advice would be to remove the softwares from the checksum, and I think it would be a lot faster.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Any more questions? Okay.
What is the strategy to backup OCS?
Yeah. The strategy to backup? That's a good question. I don't do that a lot. Maybe FX can
yes,
can answer.
Two things to do. You have to dump the MySQL database,
mm-hmm.
and to grab the directory of the web.
So OCS reports.
Yeah.
And the downloads directory, because it's a package deployment directory?
Yes, and you have to back up all your packages.
Like the software installation packages.
Yeah.
Yes.
So we plan to improve quite a lot on this SOAP API. It has a few flows, and it can be like cleaner. It could serve real SOAP data, so we don't have to parse XML after that, and that can be automated a bit more, I think. So that's a work in progress, along with other things.
So you're using this Perl SOAP Lite library, right?
Yeah.
Is that
which is not light at all.
Is it causing the fragments in the XML?
Sorry?
Is that library causing the fragments in the XML?
In fact, the fragments are caused by the way OCS gives back its data to this library. The library itself can output very good XML, but you have to give it good data in entry.
So
that's
the library has problems to map your data model into
your
data model.
And I think the job was not done cleanly enough, so that could be better.
Are you planning to publish WSDL files for the?
Yeah, you asked me already about that a long time ago. It would be nice. So yeah, I think it might be part of a major rewrite of the SOAP API.
I think you basically can skip all this writing your client stuff, just generate it and it's very easy to update that.
Yeah, that's the idea. But then again, the fact that OCS is customizable and you can add your plugins and everything keeps your data model very flexible, and it adds a level of configuration for when people must deploy plugins. So it has to be done well, I think.
So the plugin deployment has some effects on the web service.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.